After a review of the basic data types of Python, let us move to the composite data types. These are essentially lists, dictionaries, and sets. At least these are the most common ones. A list is simply a sequence of things. For example, a list L is equal to the elements A, B, and C. So we use square brackets to delimit a list and comma to separate the elements. Okay, we can print a list. We can put strings in a list, and we can print the various elements. We can index them using the square bracket notation with the index of the element, beginning from 0 as always. One thing is that lists are a little bit different from arrays in other languages, in that the elements are not required to be of the same type. You can put in integers, floating points, strings, objects of any kind. So in this respect, Python is quite liberal. Of course, you have to be careful that when you use the elements, you have to know of what type they are. But there is nothing wrong in having a list with mixed element types. Once you have a list, you can append elements via the append operator. So you can append a spider to your ABC list. You can sum two lists, which concatenates them. And there are many more list operations, so you should look at the documentation to see a list of them all. You can, for instance, pop out an element, which removes the element from the list. You can reverse a whole list. You can sort a list, we can add a cat and then sort it. We can also do things as follows. So if I have a single string, I can convert it to uppercase in this way, and I can capitalize it via the dot capitalize command. So suppose I want to capitalize all the elements in a list. How can I do that? A simple notation is called the list comprehension, which has this notation. So this notation begins and ends with a bracket to remind you that you are creating a new list. And you see what it says. It says s.capitalize for s in L. So this will iterate over all the elements s of the list L and apply the capitalize operation to each one of them, giving you the resulting list. Okay, so if we do these, we get A, B, C, and cat, you know, starting with capital letters. And you can also, in this list comprehension notation, put conditionals. So you say for S in L, if, and then you add the condition that the element S has to satisfy to be considered in the iteration. For instance, you can write s.capitalize for S in L, if S starts with C, and so you will only capitalize the elements of your original list that start with a C and obtain C and cat. Okay, the other elements A and B are not considered. Okay, so this is a very nice notation, essentially to produce a new list on the basis of an old one, and we will use it often in the class. Okay, so you can ask for the length of a list, and here I give you a pointer to more list functions. Now, you can also have tuples in Python. Tuples are essentially lists whose elements you cannot modify. So it's an immutable list. It seems like a limitation, and you may wonder why we want something that looks like a list but can do fewer things, but there are actually uses for it, and so we might as well consider the data structure now. So P1 and P2 are two tuples. They are two points, essentially, in 2D, if you will. We can access them as if they were a list. So we can ask for the 0 and 1 elements of this P1, of this point 1. We could also trust that P1 has two elements and say x, y is equal to P1. When you know how many elements there are in a tuple, you can take the tuple apart by simply assigning it to the corresponding number of variables. Okay? That's a very handy and quick way of taking apart something that has been put together as a tuple, or as a list, more rarely. Okay? Now, if you, of course, take it out in the wrong number of variables, you get an error. So if you try to unpack the point 2, which is again a two-component point, into three variables, you get an error, not enough values to unpack. Okay? You can also use, it's a sort of a common shorthand, the underscore, to mean a variable whose value you will not be caring about in the future. Underscore is just a variable name like any other, but by convention in Python, underscore is meant to mean that you do not care about that particular value that you assign to it. One very useful thing you can do is slice a list. That is, if you have a list, and the same works for strings, by the way, that are considered to be sort of character lists. But so if you have a list, you can take portions of it, sublists of it, essentially. If you use the notation colon and then a number, you get up to that element with that element excluded. So if you have this list and you will ask up to the third element excluded, you will get so 0, 1, 2, and the fish is excluded. So we should get cat, dog, and bird. Okay, and if you use three colons, so the index and then a colon, then you get from the index included onwards, okay? So in this case, we get fish and fly. So the idea, by the way, is that if you go up to some point and then from that point on, and you would concatenate these two lists, we would obtain the original list, as you can see. Okay, you can also go from a position to another one. The first position is always included, the last position is always excluded. So in this case, we get two elements, dog and bird, right? 0, 1 included, 2, and then 3 is excluded. So we get just dog and bird. Okay, this is a very handy notation, not the least because you never get errors. You can say, for example, L from 3 to 100, and instead of getting an error, you just get as much as you possibly can. Okay? So that's handy. So if you use negative numbers, you're counting backwards from the end of the list, which is super useful because you can very easily get the last element of a list, or the penultimate elements on, so ant and fly, you know, these are the last two, and so on and so forth. As a matter of fact, L of minus 2 would give you just ant. Okay, so you can count from the end of the list and not only from the beginning by using negative numbers to count from the end. This is very convenient. Yeah, so here I mentioned that it never generates errors, so it's very nice. But of course, if you tried to print an element not using slicing but an explicit index and the element doesn't exist, you would get an index error. Okay? Dictionaries are the next important data type in Python. Dictionaries are best understood as a mapping from a set of keys to a set of values. So they enable you to associate keys that you look up to values that are the result of the lookup. Let me give you an example. We can define here a dictionary called n of paws, number of paws, that associates 4 to cat, 0 to fish, 2 to bird, and 0 to snake. So we can define it. And then we can look stuff up in the dictionary. For example, if we say n of paws of fish, we will be looking up the value associated with fish that is going to be a 0. Okay? So this is a common way to build a dictionary using this braces notation. You can also create them using this notation. Dict is the dictionary constructor. You say dog equals 4, cat equals 4, bird equals 2, fish equals 0. And this gives you a dictionary D. Okay, of course, in this case, you have the limitation that the name of the keys need to be variable names. Here, if you define it with this notation, keys can be arbitrary. They can also be numbers, for instance. Okay? If you ask for a key that does not exist in a dictionary, Python complains. So if I say number of paws of an elephant, okay, this will generate a key error because there is no elephant in the dictionary. So if you want to avoid these type of key errors, what you should do is use the get statement. So you say dictionary.get, and we can get a fish or an elephant. For the fish, we will get the value, and for an elephant, we will get none. If we want, we can define a default value for an elephant. For example, we can write, I have no idea. Right? And in this case, we get the default value instead. Okay? Otherwise, we get none. We can test for membership in a dictionary for a key with the in operator. We can test elephant in number of paws or cat in number of paws, and we get in one case false for the elephant and true for the cat. So suppose we have a list of animals, and suppose you want to translate them according to the number of paws. You can use a list of comprehension like this. As we saw before, you can say number of paws dot get a for a in animals. So this will iterate over your list of animals, and for each one of them we'll try to get the number of paws from the dictionary. Okay, so if we run this, we get none if the animal is not part of the dictionary, and otherwise we get the number of paws. If you have a dictionary, you can get its keys via the dot keys operator. Okay, and you can also iterate over the keys. You can also iterate over the values using the dot values operator. And this is very useful, you can also iterate over the key value pairs. Okay, so you see these dot items gives me the pairs of key and value that are corresponding. And because it's a pair, I can take it apart, as we saw before for pairs, into k and v. So k will be the key, v will be the value, and I can print it like that. Now this seems great, and it is mostly great, except for one incredibly unfortunate choice of the designers of Python 3, that decided that what you get out of these operations are not really the lists of keys, values, or key-value pairs, but as some iterators. You see, this was indicated, for those of you who paid attention to this quirk, by these dict keys. It's not quite a list that you get, it's this dict keys of a list that you don't know what it means. Essentially, this has the following consequence, that dot keys of a dictionary gives you something that iterates over the dictionary. But if you modify the dictionary, the modification will be reflected in the iteration. Let me give you an example that will make it clear. Imagine I have a dictionary with the two elements, Luca mapping to 4, Anna mapping to 5. Then I take the set of keys of the dictionary that it should be Luca and Anna, and I put it into S. Then I add a key value correspondence to the dictionary, by saying that the dictionary value associated with key Helen is 8, and then I iterate over S, printing simply the name of the key in S. Maybe I can just call this K to be clearer. Okay, this should be just a key. So if I do this, what is the expected answer? Well, I set S to the set of keys here. The set of keys at that point was Luca and Anna, so here I should be just getting Luca and Anna as output. And instead I get also Helen, because this object S is not quite a list, it's an iterator over the keys, and so if I mutate the dictionary by adding one entry, so does the iteration associated with this S. So if you just wanted to iterate over the keys that were at that point, you need to explicitly take the list of those keys, and then it will work. Okay, and you get just Luca and Anna. Because differently from above, here I explicitly freeze the result into a list, so even if I change the dictionary later, what I get out of the iteration will not change. So the same is true also for values and items. So essentially this was a bad idea of the design. Essentially it's a little bit cheaper from the point of view of implementation to give you an iterator rather than going to the trouble of actually building a list, because when you build a list, you need to make a copy of the values. So the implementers of Python 3 decided that they would prize efficiency. And this is a somewhat unfortunate choice, because in practice, it's much better to prize a sanity of mind and make sure that when you get the set of keys or values, the set of keys or values is well defined at that point and it will not change later. So it's an unfortunate choice, but you have to know it. And the way to get out of it is simply by taking explicitly a list whenever you use these iterators for storing in a variable, as we do here, rather than when you use them immediately, as we were doing here. If you use them immediately, then it's fine. There is no problem. The last of our three data structures is sets. Sets are a representation for a set of elements. So you can think of them like a list, except for two big differences. In a set, things are not in any order. And in a set, you cannot have duplicate elements. Okay, so these are the two essential differences. It's a list without ordering, so in which you cannot say, give me the third element. There is no third element in a set. And you also cannot have two copies of the same element. Okay, so we can build the sets using this braces notation, just like for sets, but there is no colon here to denote the key-value correspondence. So we can create one set containing a cat and a dog, bird, mouse, cat, dog, cat, and we can take union, intersection, and difference of sets. So let's run this code and see what happens. This is, by the way, is the notation for an empty set. We cannot use open and close brace because that's already an empty dictionary, right? So we can build these sets and we can print the union, intersection, and set difference. So the union is the elements that are in both sets. You see that the duplicate cat is removed from the union. It appears only once. This is the intersection, so there is gonna be cat in the intersection between set 1 and set 2. And you can also compute the set difference, that is the elements that are in one set but not the other. Okay. Set equality is defined as element-wise equality, so two sets are equal if they have the same elements. So set 1 and set 3 will be equal, even though I define them separately, right? And you see that the order doesn't matter. Here is cat dog and here is dog cat. But once the elements are inside a set, as I mentioned, the order is not important. You can add elements to a set. You can say set one add a duck or add a dog, and you can print it, etc. So you can add elements to it. And if you add an element that's already in, the set doesn't change. You can check for membership using the in operator. You can check cat in set 1 or opossum in set 1. One is true, the other one is false. Okay? And so you can use these unicity of elements in a set as a trick that is quite useful a number of times. So suppose you have a list and you want to know if there are repeated elements. Okay? One way is to transform the list into a set and then back into a list. This would remove the duplicated elements. And a quick trick you can do is this. If you have a list L as before, you can say if the length of L is equal to the length of the set of L, okay, you can say print the elements are unique. Else, you can say print there is a repeated element, right? Because if the list is as long as it's set, it means that there are no duplicates that have been removed in creating the set. Okay? Why does this give me an error? Because I wrote a single equal sign, which is an assignment and not a test. Okay? So I should write it that way. There is a repeated element. Okay? It's a very handy way of checking for the presence of repeated elements in a list. You could also do the same if you wanted to remove duplicates from a list without changing the order of the elements in the list as follows. We will accumulate the unique elements here in this list unique. We remember in a set of occurrences the elements we have already seen, and so we write a loop. We loop over the elements S of our list L. If has not occurred before, we add it to the list of unique elements, and we remember that it has occurred. And if S has occurred, we don't do anything, so we skip it. Okay, so this code will preserve the order of the elements in the list L, but remove all the duplicates. Okay, so you can check that this list is unchanged, except for the removal of duplicates.